When Congress debated the purchase of Thomas Jefferson's library in 1815, many lawmakers objected to the massive size of the collection, with its enormous breadth of seemingly unrelated topics. They agreed that the U.S. should buy Jefferson's books about statecraft, legal history, and political philosophy, sure. But why would the United States Congress need to consult books on the management of fruit trees, lectures on chemistry, or tracts on steam engines? Jefferson replied, "There is, in fact, no subject to which a member of Congress may not have occasion to refer." Thomas Jefferson possessed an extraordinary mind that very often found occasions to develop interconnected ideas and to apply those ideas across disciplines. My name is Patrick Hastings. I'm an education outreach specialist in the Rare Book and Special Collections Division. And I'd like to share with you Jefferson's innovative design for a moldboard plow, evidence of his remarkable ability to combine his knowledge of mathematics, agriculture, and the Republican form of government. As a statesman and political philosopher, Jefferson believed that the future of the American Republic was rooted in the soil, that an agrarian society of independent, family-sized farms would be imbued with the virtues of a strong work ethic, individual liberty, self-sufficiency, and respect for the natural world. He imagined that an agrarian America would be immune to the corruption and exploitation that he associated with rising systems of manufacturing and commercial capitalism. In his book, Notes on Virginia, Jefferson asserts that those who labor in the earth are the chosen people of God, that farmers keep alive the sacred fire of genuine virtue. While we know Jefferson primarily as an American statesman, he was also an Enlightenment thinker, dedicated to educating himself on all available knowledge. So, he bought Newton's Principia and taught himself calculus. He studied Robert Simpson's Elements of Euclid and taught himself advanced geometry. All of these interests come together in Jefferson's moldboard plow of least resistance. The plow, one of humanity's oldest and most important tools, cultivates the soil for the planting of crops. Essentially, the blade of the share at the base of the plow pierces the sod and lifts up the soil as it moves through the field. The moldboard is the surface behind the plowshare. In the late 1780s, while Jefferson was serving as the U.S. minister to France, he observed the plows used in the French countryside and resolved to improve on the design. Over the next few years, he applied concepts from Euclidean geometry and Newtonian calculus to design a moldboard in the shape of two wedges combined at right angles with a curved plane that would most efficiently lift the sod up and turn it over exactly 180 degrees as it fell back to the earth. This brought the deeper, nutrient-rich soil to the field's surface, creating a fertile bed for crops. The design's precise angles and curvature also reduced resistance, minimizing the exertion of force required by the mule and the farmer. Jefferson claimed that his design was mathematically demonstrated to be perfect, as far as perfection depends on mathematical principles. But he wasn't content to conceive of the mathematical design. He was determined to refine the device through hands-on practice in the field. Now, it's appropriate to note that Jefferson was an enslaver, and more often than not, he would not have been the person plowing the fields of Monticello. That said, Jefferson did spend 5 years testing and tweaking his moldboard plow before publishing its design in the 1799 issue of Transactions, the Journal of the American Philosophical Society. In this piece, Jefferson explains the innovations and effects of his moldboard plow and provides instructions on how to actually build it, specifying where and how deeply to saw into the block of wood. Jefferson supplements his written directions with a series of 2D and 3D geometrical figures that illustrate the design. Although Jefferson admits that it's easier to understand the design by seeing it in person than by words or figures, he nonetheless offers a highly technical and detailed description. For example, the top of the mold board should overjet the perpendicular 4.5 inches in a height of 12 inches to ensure that the weight of the sod shall preponderate over its elasticity. This is an angle of nearly 22 degrees. Despite Jefferson's best efforts to make this design accessible and practical, it's still pretty complex. Jefferson himself confessed that I am sensible that this description may be thought too lengthy and elaborate for a subject which has hardly been deemed worthy the application of science. But if the plow be in truth the most useful of the instruments known to man, its perfection cannot be an idle speculation. Jefferson may have been an elite intellect, but he was an anti-elitist. Within his idealized agrarian republic, Jefferson envisioned better-educated citizens serving in collaboration with those working in agriculture. He put this ideal into practice by providing precise instructions for others to duplicate the perfect plow for use on their own farms. He published the design freely and did not seek a patent. In Jefferson's ingenious conception of his moldboard plow, and in his decision to share its design with both the learned and the laborer, he was modeling the kind of virtue that he believed was essential to a successful republic. This makes Thomas Jefferson both a founding father and a founding farmer.